Welcome back, my dear students. I was talking about the different lab investigations that can be done during diabetes mellitus. Now we'll talk about an important lab investigation, that is oral glucose tolerance test, OGTT. There is something called as intravenous glucose tolerance test. However, that is not very important right now. I'll talk from an exam point of view, and that is OGTT. What is this oral glucose tolerance test? Now, what is this? What are the indications for OGTT? Whenever we have symptoms which are suggestive of diabetes mellitus, but the fasting blood glucose is inconclusive, then OGTT is advised. During pregnancy, definitely for each and every pregnant female, OGTT is done. Either the OGTT or the modified OGTT, what we call as mini OGTT, is also done. It is a requirement by which is recommended, and it is always done for all and each and every pregnant female during pregnancy. Plus, it is also very important in pregnant females who have got history of past miscarriages, or history of a huge baby before, or there is excessive weight gain during pregnancy, or there is past history of miscarriage, past history of big baby. In these cases, it is definitely advised that the pregnant female has to undergo OGTT, especially for the diagnosis of what we call as gestational diabetes mellitus. And one more indication is in renal glycosuria, because renal glycosuria is very benign, it doesn't need treatment. So for this sake also, we need to do OGTT. So these are the indications. Exam point of view, you should be knowing about that. What is the preparation? What is the method? Now, any person who is supposed to undergo OGTT is advised to have good carbohydrate diet for at least 3 days. So after 3 days, whatever diet he is not supposed to do any extra starvation or extra fasting. The patient is supposed to avoid drugs. He is supposed to abstain from smoking and avoid strenuous exercise at least for the day of the examination. Now, in the first step, what is done? The fasting sample is withdrawn for blood glucose. Then what is done? A glucose load is given to the patient. Now, we are in this glucose tolerance. What is happening is we are trying to see the body's response to a load of glucose. If I am going to give so much glucose, is insulin released? Will this blood glucose come down? What will happen? What is the response of the body to a glucose load? Can the body tolerate glucose? That is the meaning of glucose tolerance test. So in this second step, once we have withdrawn the blood, now we give a load of glucose. How much of glucose to be given? 75 grams of anhydrous glucose. And in children, it is given as 1.75 grams per kg body weight. This much, 75 grams is a huge quantity. If you look at a packet of Glucon-D, it is a 100 gram packet. So out of that, nearly 75. But we are talking of anhydrous. So anhydrous Glucon-D is what is given, will be much more than that. It will be around 80 grams of Glucon-D will be dissolved in 250 to 350 ml of water. And that person who has come as fasting, who has come after an overnight fast, is supposed to drink that much of glucose. Is it palatable? Sometimes it is not. So these people, again, we give some other palatable things along with it, so that the glucose water goes inside. Can he eat anything else after this? No. Can he drink anything else? Maybe other than water, nothing else is supposed to be drunk by these people. Only flavored Glucon-D or flavored glucose is what is given to these people during the GTT. And fully during this time, no, he is not going to smoke, he or she is not going to do any strenuous exercise, nor are they going to get very much stressed out. So all drugs are also avoided during this time. So once this is done, in the blood and urine are collected every half an hour, that is every 30 minutes, for how long? For 2.5 hours. So we will have nearly 5 samples. The first sample plus 30 minute sample, 60 minute sample, 90 minute sample, 120 minute sample, and the 150. But nowadays they say that it is enough if you take 120 sample. Some people go up to 150 minute sample also. So every 30 minutes for the next 2.5 hours. Now, as I was telling, there is something called as modified OGTT or mini OGTT. In this, the first sample is taken, load is given, that is glucose load is given, and the 2 hour sample is what is taken out. So, first sample, we will have only 2 samples and both will be along with blood. Urine sample is also taken from the patient. So, with this, let us look at what will be the things that can happen. The interpretation of this test. Now, normally the fasting blood glucose or plasma glucose should be between 70 to 110 milligrams per dl, and the 2 hour post load should be less than 140. Please remember this value. Fasting is between 70 to 110 milligram per dl, and this 2 hour post load should be less than 140 milligram per dl. This is normal fasting and post load. What will be his diagnostic criteria in case of diabetes mellitus? When do we say anybody is having diabetes mellitus? If his fasting glucose is more than 126 milligram per dl. Now this may be during this OGTT, or it may be due to simply because without the load also we can say that if it is more than one occasion, fasting is more than 126 milligram per dl. We call that person as diabetic. This is normal, this is diabetic. Normal and diabetic. Diabetic more than 126. And what will be his 2 hour post load? 2 hour post load, if it is more than 200 milligram per dl. 2 hour post load is more. This is again normal and this is diabetic. 200 milligrams per dl, if it is more than that, we call that person more than one occasion, actually not on a single occasion, normal and diabetic. 2 hour post load more than 200 milligram per dl, either it may be this or in the same occasion both are there, then also we say that the person is having diabetes. For this it should be more than one occasion singly. For this also it should be more than one occasion singly. But if it is on the same occasion both are present, then the person is definitely considered as diabetic mellitus. Now other condition is when the random is also more than 200 milligrams per dl on any more than one occasion, then also we say that the person is diabetic. These are the diagnostic criteria for diabetes mellitus. This is given by the American Diabetic Association. Now let us look at what is happening in the GTT. This is happening. I have talked about both the GTT and the without the load also. Postprandial could be without the load also. It should not exceed more than 200 milligram. Normally it should be less than 140. Now let us look at what is happening in the GTT. Normal glucose tolerance. How will the curve look like? What will be the, as I was saying, we are going to estimate every 30 minutes. So please look at this slide. So we have the blood glucose levels in milligram percentage, and these are the timings in minutes, and this is the renal threshold, which is 180 milligrams per dl. Again at the same time we have taken the blood glucose and we have estimated the blood glucose and taken the urine for Benedict's test. So in a normal person, the blood glucose, the GTT will look somewhat like this. Please look here. The GTT will look somewhat like this in the slide. So if you plot the graph, not even a single value will cross the renal threshold. The peak is reached within 1 hour and that also never crosses the renal threshold. True 2, the blood glucose is going to increase. Why? Because you have given a glucose load. But that glucose load is brought down by insulin. So it is going to come down and the glucose level are nearly going to be the same as that of fasting by the end of 2 hours or 2 and a half hours. So sometimes at end of 2 hours, it may still go below the fasting levels and there might be a slight increase later on, which is happening because of gluconeogenesis or glycogen degradation when the insulin action is stopped. But this is how the GER will look like. At the 2 hours, it will reach back to nearly the fasting levels. So this is the characteristic feature of a normal GTT, normal fasting blood glucose. Now we go on to I told to you about 70 to 110 and more than 126. What to do about these people? Somebody's blood glucose level is 115. What will you do? His plasma fasting blood glucose is 115. Or is this is between 140 to 200. What if it is more than 140 but less than 200? Maybe it is around 180. So what to do for these people? We call them as impaired glucose tolerance. We call them as having impaired. They are neither diabetic nor they are normal. They are having impaired glucose tolerance. So what to do? These people have to be followed up routinely. They are at an increased risk of getting overt diabetes mellitus. So it is essential that these people are at a stage where they can go back to being normal also if proper diet, exercise and lifestyle modifications are done in these people. So it becomes essential. That is why impaired glucose tolerance test is one of the indications for doing GTT. So as I was telling, fasting blood glucose is between 110 to 126 and 2 hour post load is between 140 to 200 milligrams. So if you plot a graph of this impaired GTT, it will be neither be like that of, please look it here, it will neither be like that of a diabetic or nor it will be like that of a normal person. It will be in between. So maybe one or two samples may even give the urine Benedict's test positive because you have given a big glucose load of nearly 75 grams. Maybe one or two samples may come either positive or maybe it may not come also. If it is around 180 plus, it will around 190. That is still 2 hour post load. It may give, but it may not give also. So this is how a impaired GTT graph will look like. Now we have got one more term, that is impaired fasting glycemia. Impaired fasting glycemia is IFG. That is also fasting blood glucose is between 110 to 126. Between this range, we call it as impaired fasting glycemia is between this range. Impaired glucose tolerance, even this is within this range. Impaired glucose tolerance, IGT, is between both. They are having both impaired fasting glycemia and there is a difference in the postprandial 2 hour load. Whereas impaired fasting glycemia, this is normal and only this is in between. The 2 hour post load is less than 140 milligrams per DL. So again for them, what is the treatment? We keep on following them up and tell them they are also at much lesser risk when compared to impaired glucose tolerance, but they also need to be followed up. Especially we may have to do it one more occasion and then see what to do further. Now we have got one more term here known as renal glycosuria, and this is how the graph will look like. Please look at this slide. I have got blood glucose levels and this is the renal threshold. Now we say renal GTT when the renal threshold has decreased. So this is a benign condition. In this benign condition, the person is not having diabetes mellitus, but unfortunately there is some problem with his kidneys. The kidney threshold, remember that 180 milligrams, that has come down. Usually it is a benign condition. Renal threshold has decreased. I have given the value here in this graph as 100 milligrams, but it could be anywhere, maybe less than 180, it could be anything. The value could be anything. Now this is renal glycosuria is also one of the indications for doing OGTT, oral glucose tolerance test. So if you look at the GTT curve, the curve will be similar to that of a normal GTT, but only thing is his Benedict test with urine will come positive. Either one sample may come positive, either the 30-minute sample or the 60-minute sample may come positive. Why? If you look at the blood glucose, his blood glucose is normal, but there is a problem. So your glucose is going to get excreted in the urine. So Benedict's test is going to come positive. So is he diabetic mellitus? No, he is not diabetic mellitus. He is not having hyperglycemia. He is not coming under the classification of this classification. So only his urine Benedict's tests are coming positive. So such people are called as said to have renal glycosuria. And this is how the graph, normal graph with the decreased renal threshold. Normal graph with decreased renal threshold. Now there is one more type of graph that can be obtained, and that is called as lag type of GTT. Lag type of GTT is also called as elementary glycosuria. Please note the name. It is elementary, something related to GI tract. It is not ELI, it is ALI, elementary glycosuria. Now what is happening is ALI, elementary stands for, it is a type of, due to GI tract problems, it is also called as a lag type of GTT. Lag, I'll tell you what is, why do we call it as lag. Now if you look at the graph, if you look at the blood samples, and the, if you are going to plot a graph of this blood glucose versus, and also the urine Benedict's test, this is 70, this is 70. If I am going to see the different blood glucose levels at different times, we will find that there is a sharp increase at the 30-minute level. There is a huge increase in the blood glucose level. Now, why is this happening? Then he comes back to normal. So, at around the 30-minute time, there will be a spike in the GTT. Now, why is this happening? Here there is a delay in the release of glucose. Glucose is getting absorbed from the intestine, it increases. Remember, in normal people, when it increases, insulin is going to be secreted. Now in these people, there is a lag, there is a delay. The pancreatic cells lag behind the intestine. They are not at the same pace as the intestine, they lag behind. Hence, this is also called as the lag type of GTT. Now the blood, if you look at the fasting blood glucose, will be normal, but maybe one sample, especially the 30 minute sample, which will come positive. At least some amount of glucose may be present in the urine. So it exceeds the renal threshold, so Benedict's test will be positive, but it rapidly and comes back, rapid return and complete return back to normal. We have another type, diabetic GTT. I won't talk about it, because in diabetics, actually once they are diagnosed as diabetic, GTT is contraindicated. We are not going to give an extra load of glucose to see if his beta cells are able to synthesize insulin. No, we know that he is diabetic. We are not going to do a GTT anymore. Okay, but this is how a GTT graph may look like, with all the blood values increasing more than the renal threshold, and all the Benedict's tests also may come positive. Previously, there was a word used like moderate diabetic, severe diabetics. Nowadays, we don't use it, either diabetic or non-diabetic or impaired glucose tolerance test or impaired fasting glycemia. These are the terms that are currently being used. These are the terms that are being recommended by the American Diabetic Association. Blood glucose never reached normal in a diabetic GTT. Now, I'll talk about two more estimations which I said. One is glycated hemoglobin estimation. Now please look here, it is used as an indicator for long-term blood glucose levels. So you want to look for the blood glucose level over a period of time. We don't know whether when we do blood glucose, we come to know of the blood glucose level on that day. But we don't know what had happened 1 week before. We don't know what had happened 1 month before. So you want to know what is his compliance of drugs, how is his body regulating blood glucose over a period of time, we need to do some other test. And one of the test is hemoglobin, glycated hemoglobin estimation. So whenever there is hyperglycemia, proteins in the body may undergo glycation. This is a non-enzymatic process in which glucose gets attached to the N-terminal valine of the beta chain of hemoglobin. Now it is called as HbA1c. Once attached to hemoglobin, it won't be removed. It will remain with the hemoglobin. So it will remain in the RBCs, and RBCs have a span lifespan of 120 days. So we can come to know how much of RBCs have glycated, and then we come to know what is his blood glucose control over a span of 3 months, 120 days. So glycated hemoglobin estimation. Please remember that it is the rate of formation of HbA1c is proportional to glucose level. An elevated HbA1c indicates poor control of blood glucose in the previous 2 to 3 months. Normally HbA1c is 4 to 8%, and in diabetics it may range from 10 to 15%, and this should be estimated every 3 months. I have got one more test, last test, we'll talk about it, microalbuminuria. Now, micro means small albumin? No, micro here stands for the quantity. Now, normally in albumin in the urine is less than 30 milligrams per day. If the excretion of albumin is more than 300 milligrams per day, it can be detected by routine urine analysis. We call it as proteinuria. But in between 30 to 300, we call it as microalbuminuria. We require a different method to detect this low levels between 30 to 300. This is important for the early detection of diabetic nephropathy. So I have to talk about hypoglycemia. Please remember, hypoglycemia is a medical emergency when the blood glucose levels are less than 40, and it is characterized by CNS symptoms like confusion, aberrant behavior, and they may go into death, but it gets resolved on administration of glucose. Body defense is glucagon and epinephrine, and decreased insulin. Symptoms are adrenergic symptoms where we have anxiety, tremor, sweating when blood glucose falls rapidly. Neuroglycopenic due to impaired delivery of glucose to brain. We have headache, confusion, slurred speech, seizures, coma, and death. Usually seen when the blood glucose falls gradually and there is fall slowly and it fails to trigger a epinephrine response. Last thing, what are the causes? Insulin induced hypoglycemia when there is an insulin overdosage. Postprandial hypoglycemia, exaggerated insulin release following meal. This is transient with mild adrenergic symptoms. Fasting hypoglycemia, more common in individuals who have a hepatocellular damage or an adrenal insufficiency or alcohol intoxication. Remember, an alcoholic will not be taking glucose also. He may end up having fasting hypoglycemia. Insulinoma is an uncanny condition in which there is a tumor of the beta cells which release insulin erratically, leading to fasting hypoglycemia. In alcohol, so many other things will be important, including the NADH-NAD+ ratio, which is responsible for stopping gluconeogenesis and to decrease the blood glucose level. So with this, we come to the end of how blood glucose levels are regulated within the body. What is diabetes mellitus, which is hyperglycemia, what is hypoglycemia, its adrenergic and neuroglycopenic symptoms. Thank you.